to me. Oh, oh, I despise. Cause it means the destruction of this life.
We're here at the headquarters of the Marquis de Lafayette for a press conference being held in Portsmouth, Virginia. The Marquis de Lafayette, head of the French Army, has joined forces with the Continental Army, which is under the command of General George Washington.
Good day to all assembled here in this grand day. It is with great excitement that I stand here before you. As you all know, General Cornwallis has settled in at Yorktown and is making life quite difficult for those of us interested in seeing these new United Colonies stand as an independent and free country.
General Lafayette, why is France helping the colonists in their war against the English?
Let me say first that the French people support freedom from oppression for all people. The English have grown greedy and cruel. Their King George is not content to be king of their country, but rather he wishes to be king of the world.
What do you say to those Englishmen who feel that they have a right to guide the colonists? Because if not for their founding of the Jamestown colony in 1607, there would be no America.
I would say that the founding of America was inspired by God, and the English were the recipients of God's grace. However, that does not give them the right to be God.
What is your opinion of the British commander, Sir Charles Cornwallis?
General Cornwallis is a formidable opponent. He has settled in quite nicely at Yorktown, where he knows this war will be won or lost, depending on which side gains the upper hand.
Are you in contact with General Washington?
But of course. In fact, I've recently informed General Washington of a new secret weapon that I've brought into our employ. Allow me to introduce Monsieur James Armistead.
I am James. My employer is Mr. Armistead.
No, 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 James. You now work for the United States of America.
That is my goal, to be a free and equal citizen of these United States of America.
My good man, you and all of us have been inspired by Mr. Jefferson's poetic declaration, which was signed by many of the leading men of this great experiment, based on truth and justice for all.
Yes, General. If I am allowed to live by the truth of that powerful document, then my heart will know the joy of freedom.
But of course, it must be made so that you benefit by what is promised to all men of justice.
Where do you reside?
In the Tidewater region of Virginia, in the town of Portsmouth.
Mr. Armistead, is your legal status indentured servant or slave?
I am enslaved.
But that would not be the case once this country is free and independent of the oppressive rule of a distant king.
General, that is my sincere hope, and so I will do all that I can for what you have asked of me.
What will Mr. Armistead be doing to help the Patriots win this war?
Ah, yes, that is what must be discussed. Come, our time is short. Cornwallis grows stronger with each passing day.
General, may we discuss my orders just one last time, please?
But of course. James, this is a map of a road leading to Yorktown. You will be accompanied by my men until you reach Hampton.
I thought it was to Williamsburg.
My lieutenants advise against that. The roads are crowded with redcoats, and we do not wish to reveal our relationship to you.
You don't think General Cornwallis will know that James is working for the Patriots?
Oh no, they will assume he is a slave, seeking the promise of freedom for those who join the British forces. They will welcome him into their bosom and speak openly before him. James will then return to us and share the detail of Cornwallis' plans. Here you are, my good man, a pass from your employer.
Those would be the ID papers signed by their owners that all slaves had to carry on their persons or risk arrest.
A map of the area, then a second decoy map, a list of herbs that you are seeking in your position as a cook, and finally, a letter requesting the protection of the British Crown. Be sure that you do not confuse the matter and hand over the wrong document when pressed. Good luck, sir.
Thank you, General. I'm off.
As we follow James Armistead on his exciting journey, it looks as if we have a break in the action as Mr. Armistead decides to wait until the road is a little less crowded. Perhaps now would be a good time to explain how James Armistead became a spy in the American Revolution. It starts with the Marquis de Lafayette. Although he had a reputation for being impetuous in military matters. Excuse me? What does impetuous mean? It means that the Marquis de Lafayette sometimes acted without thinking about all of the possibilities. Well, like I was about to say, the Marquis de Lafayette was wise to employ James Armistead as a spy because...
A spy needs to be intelligent. A good actor. Cautious. Trustworthy. When it is time for me to return to my home in France, I will most happily provide James Armistead with this document, which reads, "This is to certify that the bearer, by the name of James, has done essential services to me while I had the honor to command in this state. His intelligences from the enemy's camp were industriously collected and most faithfully delivered. He properly acquitted himself with some important commissions I gave him and appears to me entitled to every reward his situation can admit of. Done under my hand, Richmond, November 21st, 1784, Lafayette."
Seeing that the road is now clear, James leaves his hiding place and continues on his way.
"Take me to General Cornwallis. I'm a slave seeking freedom."
Slaves generally were non-combatants, hardly noticed by enemy soldiers. Additionally, the British had made it clear that slaves would gain their freedom if they were willing to be subjects of the crown. Many enslaved men and women took the offer and joined the British forces as foragers, cooks, and servants.
"You say you are a slave striving for your freedom."
"Yes, General. I have been told that you have the power of the king and the English army to grant me my freedom."
"Are you willing to swear allegiance to the British crown?"
"I want to live as a free man."
"If we are blessed by God's grace to win this war with these bothersome colonials, you may do that here in America under the protection of the vast and benevolent British Empire."
"To our common cause, please consider me a loyal servant, General Cornwallis."
"Have you any information regarding Washington's army?"
"Yes, General, I do."
It appears that James Armistead has forgotten which pocket or boot contains the right information for General Cornwallis. Now remember, he has five different documents to keep up with: his boots, his pockets. Hold on, we're live.
"Please, share your troubles, sir."
"Lies are the devil's domain, and I'm untrained on its slippery slope, so I am lost."
"Empty your pockets. There are no secrets between us."
"It's confusing, General, because I must carry so much. This document identifies me as another man's property, and these injustices I suffer along with many of my kind whose forefathers hailed from Africa and now call these colonies home."
"It is quite interesting to me that men of such great intelligence as the likes of Franklin, Washington, Jefferson, and the others should claim freedom for themselves and yet deny it to others."
"But I still deny the rights provided to all on July 4th of 1776. And this communique provides important intelligence about General Washington's plans."
Excellent. Take off your other boot,
sir.
Oh my goodness. The other boot contains information that Lafayette warned could not fall into enemy hands. What will James do?
"Take off your other boot. You must be tired. Please, avail yourself of the humble offerings of this war camp so that you might gain some rest."
"Thank you, sir. However, I've gathered some herbs from the woods that need to be delivered to the cook if it's to make any difference in today's meal."
"Very well. You are a most dependable fellow. Moreover, this is such excellent information. I was hoping you had more intelligence like this in your other boot."
Well, I am honored to be of service, General."
And Lafayette now surround General Cornwallis' Yorktown camp. He is also cut off from escape by sea by the Comte de Grasse and the French Navy. After the surrender, 2 days later, on October 21st, 1781, Lafayette, at the request of Cornwallis, invited the general to review the maps and tactics of the battle.
Now that he has surrendered, Cornwallis is eager to review our maps and tactics used to defeat him. I toured his camp yesterday and saw much that you had provided to our successful cause.
I continue to be prepared to give my all in the cause of freedom.
This war will be officially over in a few more months, and the Americans will finally have the freedom they so desire.
These are exciting times, yes.
What about you, James? What will you do?
Sir, I come to the end of my service to you with the heaviness in my soul, for in my service to you, I was an equal among all men.
And now?
And now, enslaved once again, I will resume my services to Mr. William Armistead.
Welcome, General Cornwallis.
Thank you, General Lafayette. As you were able to see during our recent meeting, I am quite anxious to understand how the American forces were able to anticipate so many of our strategies. The British Empire is used to winning wars, and when we do not, the reason for this must be understood.
General Cornwallis, please meet the Americans' secret weapon.
James Armistead?
This man will go down in history as one of the greatest spies of all.
I offered you freedom. Why was that not enough?
General, freedom is best to be enjoyed at home. I was born here and I wish to be an American citizen with all the rights guaranteed by the Declaration of Independence.
Are you now free?
I will petition my government for my freedom, General.
Your government is ruled by men. Men who reinforced your enslavement in their precious 1776 Declaration of Independence.
This event is set in the year 1781, but Cornwallis was right about the intentions of the founders. It would be a few more years before the U.S. Constitution would define enslaved people as property and only three-fifths human.
General Cornwallis, you distort the truth of the matter. But regardless, I believe the American government will reward this man for his great service to their winning cause.
A petition presented in December 1784 died in committee.
I will not be denied.
On November 30th, 1786, a petition on behalf of James was presented with William Armistead's permission to the General Assembly. This new petition was accompanied by a certificate from Lafayette.
Persuaded of the just right which all mankind have to freedom, notwithstanding his own state of bondage, James entered into my service. He understood and performed all commands with cheerfulness and fidelity, in opposition to the persuasion and example of many thousands of his fellow slaves who had fled to the British.
In this document, I also acknowledge the man who owns me, Mr. William Armistead. He is a kind man who has done everything which can make tolerable this state of slavery. And my petition asks that he be compensated for the loss of a valuable workman. Well, I do not wish any hardship to come upon Mr. William Armistead in my quest for freedom.
James Armistead's second freedom petition was referred to the Committee of Propositions and Grievances. This second petition was presented on November 30 of 1786. The Virginia House of Delegates interviewed William Armistead and his slave James, and the determination was made that James Armistead was to be a free man on the 25th day of December 1786. New Year's Day, the Senate agreed also unanimously. On January 9th, 1787, the Speaker of the House signed the bill and James was a free man.
I take this opportunity to make my first decision as a free man. My last name shall forevermore and from this moment on be Lafayette. I will bear witness in writing with the name James Lafayette. And the name Armistead given to me as a slave shall cease to be and is no more.
March 13, 1787, the Auditor of Public Accounts issued warrants to William Armistead amounting to £250, following the determination of the value of James. This was an extraordinary sum of money for a single slave. At the time, the average amount of compensation by the state to the owner of an adult male slave executed for a crime was about £100.
By the conclusion of the year 1787, I, James Lafayette, am the proud owner of two horses and three slaves. I was fortunate to learn from the wisdom and generosity of Mr. William Armistead. He treated his slaves with respect, and that is necessary to ensure good and dependable labor.
In the 1700s, it was not unusual for a free black to own slaves. But is it ironic that some blacks own slaves? Yes, I know what ironic means. It means that something is opposite of what one would assume it to be. Hold on, this just in. On December 28, 1818, James Lafayette, at the age of 70, once again petitioned the General Assembly. This time the petition was for a pension. James Lafayette reminded the legislators of their earlier kindness towards him.
For which grateful act of his country, his heart will be fulfilled with gratitude, as long as its blood runs warm. Intended consideration whereof, he humbly prays that your honorable body will pass a law allowing a small sum of immediate relief and such moderate pension for the remnant of his days as in your wisdom shall seem just.
The General Assembly approved his petition, and James Lafayette was allowed $60 for his present relief. Beginning in 18 and twice every year thereafter, James Lafayette went to the office of the auditor, James E. Heath, in the basement of the Capitol in Richmond and collected his pension.
Oh, these funds given to me, James Lafayette, they tell the tale. To be an American citizen with all the rights and privileges laid out in the Declaration of Independence and granted by the Constitution is the greatest gift given by my God to this humble man born into slavery.
In 1824, James Lafayette was reunited with the man that he had served so well during the American Revolution. The Marquis de Lafayette returned to America for a tour of the original 13 colonies. The public clamor to see this hero of the Revolution was so great, however, that the Marquis agreed to tour all 24 states of the Union.
James, my old friend, it is so wonderful to see you.
My dear Marquis de Lafayette, there are tears in these old eyes at the sight of you.
But of course, and mine as well. You are a sight to behold. I have seen your portrait likeness above the certificate I awarded you for your services during the war.
All that I am is owed to you and God.
We are all in debt to God and to this great experiment of democracy and this new world that champions freedom for all.
Not yet for all. Indentured servitude is almost gone, but slavery grows like a weed in far too many places.
Unfortunately, there are still our wars to be fought.
Yes, and I won't be around for those, but men will not continue to live in a country championing freedom while denying it to all who live there.
James, please join me in my carriage so that we might continue our visit. I sense you have much to share about your life and freedom.
But of course, sir, I would be honored.
82-year-old James Lafayette died on his New Kent County farm on August 9, 1830, just 1 year before the Nat Turner insurrection, the Virginia legislators' famous debates about slavery. Thank you, and that's a wrap. First question here. James Lafayette, as a free black man, owned slaves. How do you feel about that?
I'm just glad more of the story is being brought up, because I'm a retired teacher. Mm-hmm. I've always been bothered by the fact that we don't tell the story very well. It doesn't have any innuendo to it. It doesn't mm-hmm. talk about free blacks. It doesn't talk about the fact that blacks owned slaves. Mm-hmm. And the rest of the story, from the slaves that ran away and joined the British, they died. Mm-hmm. And they had horrible deaths, and they got sick, and they were not taken care of. And you know, so to tell the story in a fuller way,
right.
And if you can see a bigger picture, then I don't think it is surprising that he owned slaves, because that was the way the economy worked at the time.
Right. Who had heard of James Armistead Lafayette before today?
We studied a lot of black history. Of course, it wasn't called black history.
Okay.
But we did touch on a lot of the black contributions.
Here in school, meaning here in Hampton?
No, in Suffolk.
In Suffolk?
In Suffolk, yeah.
Okay. Within the public school system?
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
I don't know that it was in the curriculum.
Okay.
But okay. The teachers would, we talked about it, they exposed
Right.
I doubt if it was in the curriculum.
Okay.
I remember the name.
Okay. Yeah. All right. Good. Wonderful. Anyone else that has heard of James Lafayette?
It being in the curriculum, not a lot.
Mm-hmm.
But a lot of us talked about, and my mother talked about it.
Oral history.
Also.
Okay.
And I'm from Michigan.
That's a really important component of what we're trying to do. Again, yes,
I was really interested in the details about the General Assembly involvement and the eventual pension and all of those things. That was really good detail.
And it's amazing. All that stuff is in the record books and everything like that. So the other goal is to involve generally non-professional actors to be a part of the cast and crew, because it's really about just getting ordinary people to be involved in the, you know, the kind of the teaching of this information, the sharing of this information.
Historically, blacks and whites have worked collaboratively to effect change. This message gets lost and suppressed.